Thank you. Greetings and welcome to the Stillwater First United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Kyle, and whether you're worshiping with us here in this space or tuning in through the live radio broadcast or the YouTube live stream, know that it is an honor to be worshiping with you today. Congratulations to each and every one of you. You effectively set your clocks forward and made it here on time. Now let's all commit to one another. If anyone walks in awkwardly about 9:15, we aren't going to smirk at them or anything, okay? And you have chosen a great day to be with us. This is a wonderful day in the life of our church. It's the first time since I've been here that I'm aware that this has happened, but we are going to have a baptism in all three of our services today. And so y'all have the joy of seeing an infant baptism, and then we have a confirmand who will be confirmed in their faith later in this year, but each of them will have one in each of our next services receiving the gift of baptism as well. So it's a great, joyous day here at Stillwater First UMC. With that in mind, I invite you to rise and embody your spirit however you're most comfortable as we sing together our opening hymn, number 2088, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High.
I invite you to join me responsively in our greeting. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We join together to praise the Lord.
Thank God assembled for one purpose.
We give thanks for those who serve God.
And we rejoice for the work of God's kingdom.
We are humbled that God loves us all. We come together from individual families to give praise to God.
As one family of God together, we sing praise and give thanks.
You may be seated. And as you are, I'd like to invite the Franzoia family to come forward at this time. It's my honor to introduce to you all, let y'all come up right here, Gabe and Rebecca Franzoya, along with their little one Benjamin and their family who comes up to support them as well. Pastor Cindy, I'll hand it over to you.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price and regardless of age. Our Lord has expressly given to little children a place among the people of God, which holy privilege must not be denied them. Remember the words of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. This morning, Gabriel and Rebecca Franzoya present their son Benjamin in recognition that he is, in fact, a child of God.
Gabriel and Rebecca, I have just a few questions for you. In presenting Benjamin for holy baptism, do you confess your faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? If so, please say we do. Do you therefore accept as your duty and privilege to live before your son a life that becomes the gospel, to exercise all godly care that he be brought up in the Christian faith, that he be taught the Holy Scriptures, and that he learn to give reverent attendance upon the private and the public worship of God? If so, please say we will. Will you endeavor to keep Benjamin under the ministry and guidance of the church until he, by the power of God, shall accept for himself the gift of salvation and be confirmed as a full and responsible member of Christ's holy church? If so, please say we will. All right, I'm going to squeeze behind you here. And I invite everyone to join with me in an attitude of prayer. Gracious, loving God, pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and upon Benjamin who receives it. May you wash away his sin, clothe him in the righteousness of Christ, so that throughout his life, that dying and being raised with Christ, he may share in Christ's final victory. Amen. Benjamin, I want to hold you here for just a little bit, and I want to introduce you to all these people out here. And there's a whole bunch more who are listening in on the radio and watching online as well. But this is going to be your family of faith. So these are the people who are going to watch you as you grow and encourage you on your journey. They're going to be there when you're taking Sunday school classes and when you're, oh, I know, I'm already tiring you out, aren't I? They're going to be there when you go to VBS in the summer, and then when you're in children's choir singing, they're going to encourage you, and they're going to see you running up and down the halls here in the church, making all sorts of noise, but they're going to celebrate you throughout your life so that you may experience and come to know through each and every one of them the grace and the love of Jesus Christ. They may know just how much God loves you as they smile back and care for you. All right. And what's the full name to be given to this child? Benjamin Michael Franzoya. Benjamin Michael Franzoya, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Mom, Dad, family, I invite you to place your hands upon Benjamin and draw on one another's shoulders. Let's pray. Benjamin, may you feel the Holy Spirit of the living God working inside of you so that you may grow and develop this and every day into being a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ all the days of your life. Amen.
Members of the household of faith, I commend to your loving care young Benjamin, whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that Benjamin may grow in the knowledge and love of God through our Savior Jesus Christ?
With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ that Benjamin, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal.
Benjamin, Benjamin, God.
bulletin somewhere, but I think I'm next. I want to highlight for you that we continue with our Rise Against Hunger celebration or emphasis during the season of Lent, where we're inviting members of our church to give up some small indulgence throughout the season of Lent, donate what they would spend on that each and every week to the church designated for Rise Against Hunger or Lent. And those funds are being combined with funds raised by other United Methodist churches in the area. And we will have a food packaging event in May where we will package over 65,000 meals to be sent around the world to places where food is scarce and people are hungry. After two Sundays, combined with other churches, we have raised together an amount. We don't have it. So we have raised together $5,595. And so just imagine a graphic that shows us well on our way towards our $25,000 goal. And so please continue to bring those donations in, and we look forward to updating you each and every week. And now I'd like to invite the children to come forward to spend some time with Miss Chris for this morning's children's conversation.
While they're coming up, Kelsey, it's in there as a graphic on Rise. Second week. I just forgot to get it in there.
Here. Come on, Elva, right here. Okay, it's very important to notice that Rowan and Aubrey match. That was very important this morning. So, good morning, friends. Something's different?
This one.
Oh, they are a little bit different. Well, they're two different people, so that's okay. So let me ask you, has anyone here seen Jesus this week? Caden, where have you seen Jesus? Okay, when Rowan was playing with Daddy with the baby dolls. Okay, that sounds like fun. All right. Miss Kayla, have you seen Jesus this week? Where did you see Jesus? Okay, see Jesus through the children. Absolutely. All the time we can see Jesus through the children. So, you know what? Our Sunday school lesson this morning is about a very special meal that Jesus ate with his friends. Jesus and his friends ate bread and drank wine together. And when we have a meal like that in church, what do we call it? Do you remember? Starts with a C. Communion. Good job, Kaden. That's right. And so when we have communion, we eat bread. And what is the bread a symbol of? Yes, Kaden? Jesus' body. And what is the juice? We drink juice here. What is the juice a symbol of? Jesus' blood. That's right. So when we take communion, we're celebrating Jesus. It's a time to remember all that he's done for us. It's a time to thank him and to remember that we should be in service to one another. But today is not a communion Sunday. So do we really need to remember those things today? But we're not taking communion. You should worship God every day. You got that right. So how about, are you going to eat a meal today? Is anyone going to eat today?
Yeah.
Everyone has to eat. So how about every time we have a meal, we think about Jesus. We remember that Jesus shared his life with us, that we can show love to others. We can think of ways that Jesus has loved us, and we can be grateful for that. Okay, we don't have to wait for Communion Sunday to be thankful for Jesus. We could thank Jesus for allowing us to have the food. Absolutely, 100%. All right, well, let's go to God now, and we'll thank him right now. Dear God, we thank you for the bread that we share, but more importantly, we thank you for Jesus and the example that he is to us. Please help us to be more like him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sanctuary Choir. We do want to let you know that our mission candle is lit to the glory of God and in memory of Bill Homerding from the United Methodist Men. With that, I invite you to join together with me as we say and pray our prayer of reflection. Lord, we come from different paths, yet we have all been affected in some manner by torn family relationships. We have struggled with want and desire, with doing things we knew we shouldn't, and with failing to place our focus upon you. We look for a time when we can put aside judgment of ourselves and others, to lay down our burdens, to find healing for relationships, to seek your face, and to find your grace. We find reassurance in the words of the psalmist, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long." As we follow you, our shepherd, we ask, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May be seated. I invite you to join with me as we affirm our faith together. I believe that God created the earth and God created me. that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, that the Holy Spirit is God in the world today. I believe that the church is the body of Christ, and that the church is spread by people telling others about Jesus, that the Bible is the word, the way, the truth. I believe that by loving your neighbor as yourself, you are serving others, that we are united together as a family of God. Amen. Pastor Kyle will be speaking to us this morning from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, verses 3 through 12. Some Pharisees came to Jesus, and to test him, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any cause?" He answered, "Have you not read that the one who made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, 'For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh?' So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." They said to him, "Why then did Moses command us to give a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her?" He said to them, "It was because you were so hard-hearted that Moses allowed you to divorce your wives, but at the beginning it was not so. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, except for unchastity, and marries another, commits adultery." His disciples said to him, "If such is the case of a man with his wife, it is better not to marry." But he said to them, "Not everyone can accept this teaching, but only those to whom it is given. For there are eunuchs who have been so from birth, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by others, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. Let anyone accept this who can." The word of the Lord, to live and to share. Thanks be to God.
I had the great benefit of having all four of my grandparents throughout my childhood. They have since passed, since I entered into adulthood, but I have many, many fond memories of spending time with my grandparents. On my mom's side, her parents were lovingly known by us grandchildren as Meemaw and Pawpaw. They lived out in Louisiana, and I remember going to visit, and then as I moved into like elementary age, they came here to Oklahoma, where we got to see them much more frequently, spend a week with them in the summer, and have a great time. I also love spending time with my father's parents. My grandfather was known as Pop, and my grandmother was known as Mom. A bit confusing, I know, but it has to do with the oldest cousin being confused by hearing his father call his mom, Mom, all the time. So the grandson just started calling her that too, and it stuck with the rest of us. But there was something unique about seeing Mom and Pop. You see, when I would go see Meemaw and Pawpaw, I saw them in the same household together. But Mom and Pop, they didn't live in the same home. They lived in different houses in the same community, really about 10 to 15 minutes apart from one another, but we had to go see them separately. And so often visits at holidays or other times when we would go to visit involved having to schedule seeing them both. You go visit one first and then go see the next, or vice versa. As I got older, I learned that they weren't allowed to be in the same room together for some reason. I realized that if we were celebrating a holiday, they wouldn't both be there. We had to be selective about who was invited to what event, what sporting event, what church event, what activity that the kids were participating in, and that when only one of them would be there at a time. And so what I learned as I got a little bit older, that they had experienced something called divorce. And that at some point along the way, they had loved each other, they had three kids together, but at some point decided they no longer loved one another. And what I was told was that, in fact, this happened while their kids were still in the home, but that they waited until my father, the youngest of three, was out of the home and in college for them to get a divorce. This all happened long before as grandkids came along. And so I learned, oh, that's what that means then. When you're divorced, you aren't together anymore. You aren't around each other. You are separated. And then I remember the first time that I remember them being in the same room together. It was following the death of my grandfather's sister. My great aunt passed away, and my grandmother had obviously had a long-term relationship with her before their divorce, and no love had been lost, you know, in the divorce, and still deeply cared about her. So my grandmother came to the funeral, and not only that, but my great aunt's family invited her to come and be part of the family meal that took place at the church prior. But she wouldn't have known that they were in the same room together because, again, one sat at one table and one sat at another table on the other side of the fellowship hall. And what I remember the most as a late elementary kid or as a preteen was I remember sitting down with my dad and my family as they were sitting with my grandfather. And then I remember being asked, could you go check on your grandmother? Can you go sit with her and make sure that she's okay? And it seems like such a simple, small request. But I remember as a little kid thinking to myself, how come a child's having to keep the peace when two adults just can't be around one another? I know that that's how a divorce impacted me in my life, and that is so small and trivial to the ways a divorce has impacted so many of your lives. For some of you, maybe it was grandparents. For some of you, maybe it's been a sibling or your parents. For some of you, maybe it's your life that has been harmed by a divorce in one way or another. And it's a common thing, it seems to be. We've all heard that statistic, right, that half of marriages end in divorce. And while that statistic is, for the most part, true, it does need to be a little bit nuanced. What we actually find, and it changes from year to year, obviously, but for the most part, what we find is that 40% of first marriages end in divorce. And then it is about 60% of second marriages that end in divorce, and then somewhere north of 70% of third marriages that end in divorce. And so it is somewhat good to know, it's not by a large majority, but a majority of first marriages remain, individuals remain married to one another. But it's when you begin to add those other statistics in that you get to that about 50% of marriages statistic. And we as a church have not always been great about addressing this topic. And in fact, what I find when I listen to, not everyone, but a lot of people of faith, I hear one of two responses when they talk about divorce. I hear people of faith say that divorce isn't even in our vocabulary. It's not something we will ever consider or ever talk about or ever think could ever happen. Divorce is just not something that Christians, it should not be part of their life. It should not be permissible. And then I hear people on the other end that say, well, when I read the scriptures, the view of divorce and the teachings of Jesus are so stringent and so strict, they're out of date, they're unreasonable, and so they don't even apply to our lives today. I believe that both of these extremes aren't the most faithful of responses. And so instead, what I think to be true is that we should probably find somewhere more in the middle where we can, yes, honor our faith and what Scripture teaches us about the topic, but also understand that there are ways in which divorce can be handled in a faithful manner. This is the third week in our sermon series, Human Frailty and Hope, where during the season of Lent, during this time in which we acknowledge our deep need for God as we prepare ourselves for the cross of Good Friday and the empty tomb of Easter Sunday, during this time, Pastor Cindy and I are talking about some of those things we face and by the fact that we are part of a frail and fallen world and where we can find hope and find God in the midst of those difficult times. This topic of divorce has been something that I've been asked to preach upon time and time again, and if you're nervous about this, know that I am too, because this is the first time I've said, okay, finally, I'll preach on it. And so we're going to have this conversation. And as we do, let's begin with a word of prayer. Gracious, loving God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to come to a safe space, to a space where we know that we are cherished and beloved by you. And so, Lord, whether we're worshiping here in this space or worshiping remotely, I pray that you would unite us by your Holy Spirit. Fill me with your Spirit. Use me as a vessel. Speak through me to share with each of us your message of truth and grace this day. Amen. So as I said, I believe that sometimes our understanding about what the Bible teaches about divorce may be a little bit misguided. And as you hear that scripture that Pastor Cindy read for us just a little bit ago, it seems pretty straightforward and kind of strict, doesn't it? We hear Jesus, there's some Pharisees, some religious leaders that come up to him and they say, you know, can a man divorce his wife for any cause? And Jesus, he begins to talk about marriage, talks about how two become one, let that which God has put together, let no one separate. He ends up then talking about how Moses allowed for people to get divorced because of their hard-heartedness. But if you get divorced for any reason other than unchastity, that what happens is you are committing adultery or causing your spouse to commit adultery should you remarry somewhere down the line. And this seems very difficult to understand and to apply what Jesus is teaching here to our lives. But what I find interesting is in my research and my study on this topic, I found that many scholars say it's really important for us to understand and to know the context and what the Bible as a whole teaches about divorce and the context into which Jesus is speaking. And that will help provide a little bit more clarity into just what Jesus is trying to share with the Pharisees and how his teachings may still apply to us today. First of all, as we think about the Old Testament, the Bible as a whole, we can probably all think of one command that has to do with divorce and marriage from the Old Testament, right? Thou shalt not commit adultery, right? It's one of the big ten. We know that one, right? We've heard it before. But as you're probably aware, there are more than just 10 commandments in the Old Testament. In fact, when you look at the first 5 books of the Bible, often referred to as the law, there are hundreds of commands and teachings about any number of topics. And so there are other places where it addresses the topic of divorce. And there's a place in the book of Exodus where it is commanded that if a man is neglectful of his wife, if he neglects her from having clothing, neglects her from having food, neglects her from having her marital rights, affection, intimacy, if he neglects her in those ways, she can divorce him without debt or without, you know, there being any punishment upon her, that she can divorce her husband. Now, when people look at scriptures, sometimes you have to ask that question, is this talking about like a very specific instance, or is this more applied to the population as a whole? And for the most part, the Jewish people and the rabbis and the leaders, you know, for centuries, they looked at this as applying to both men and women. That if you have a spouse who neglects you, your food, clothing, affection, that those are grounds for divorce. And then you add in adultery to that, and you have the 4 reasons that for most of the Old Testament and the Jewish people for why someone could get a divorce. But then in the decades leading up to Jesus, there was a Jewish rabbi named Hillel who was very influential. And he began to study the scriptures and say, hey, we've missed some things here. You see, there's a scripture in the book of Deuteronomy that talks about how a man can give his wife a certificate of divorce for the cause of adultery. So basically, if their wife has committed adultery, they don't have to go through the whole court system and the legal system. They can just give her a certificate of divorce and dismiss her. But Hillel read that scripture and he said, "Ooh, we're misinterpreting it here. What really is being said is that a man can give his wife a certificate of divorce for adultery or for any cause. So not just if she's committed adultery, but maybe he decided he doesn't like the way she looks. Or he finds someone that he likes more. Or maybe she burned dinner. Like, for any cause, he could say, I'm going to give you a certificate of divorce. And we don't have to go through this whole legal process or anything like that. I'm just going to dismiss you." And this became a popular teaching leading up to the day of Jesus. Because as you can imagine, and again, it was men. This applied only to men, not to women. But a man, for just about any reason, could decide to dismiss their wife and give them a certificate of divorce. And that became the common practice and teaching in Judaism leading up to the birth of Jesus. We also see a biblical example of this, right? When Mary becomes pregnant with Jesus and Joseph finds out, what do we read in the Gospel of Matthew? He decided to dismiss her quietly. He's going to give her a certificate of divorce because he doesn't want to go through the whole legal process. He doesn't want to pull out what seems to be her act of adultery. He doesn't want to bring that out into the community and shame her in that way. So he decides to just dismiss her quietly. Now for Joseph, this is reckoned to him as righteous. He's seen as a righteous man because of this. But the likelihood is that most men taking this option weren't doing so for righteous reasons, but for more selfish reasons. Why is this important? Because what does the scripture say? What did the Pharisees ask Jesus? Is it right for a man to divorce his wife for any cause? You see, what they're asking him is, you know, this teaching, you know, the Jewish rabbis are telling us that we men can divorce our wives for any cause. And that's the teaching of the day. Jesus, do you agree with that? Or does there need to be another reason? Which are you? Are you an any cause supporter? Or are you a supporter of adultery and possibly other reasons that there needs to be something significant for a man to divorce his wife? So it's important to understand the question that Jesus is being asked. And then how does Jesus respond? As he often does, by not answering the question immediately. Instead, we see what Jesus is most interested in. He's not as interested in divorce as he is interested in marriage. And so that's what Jesus begins to talk about. And he begins to talk and he shares with them, you know, have you not read that the one who made them at the beginning made them male and female and said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. So what Jesus is doing is he's basically saying, look, marriage and your vows and your commitment, they are important. And when two become one in mental, spiritually, physically, in such a manner, when they give themselves to one another in such a way, there is no way you can ever truly be apart from one another. You now have a piece of each other, no matter what. And then Jesus says, let no one separate, you know, what God has joined together. Let no one separate what God has joined together. And so that's what leads to many people to read that and to say, well, so divorce isn't appropriate. Like, for no reason, no circumstance, should someone get divorced. And now I'm beginning to read into this a little bit, but I think an important question for all of us to ask ourselves is the person committing the sin of separation, is it the person who's filing and finalizing the legal paperwork that leads to the divorce, or is it the individual who lied, who cheated, who lacked affection? Is it that individual who committed the sin of separation in the first place? Where does the sin lie? Was the individual who caused the separation and the pain and the heartache, or the one who signs the papers? And I believe, in my mind, likely in a lot of places, we have probably not one, but two people who have sinned and have harmed each other. And I believe that Jesus doesn't say, you can never separate, but do your best. This is a teaching to live as a person of faith and don't be someone who causes separation in a marriage. But then they ask Jesus after he said this, they say, well, then why did Moses command us to give a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her? Why did Moses command us to give a certificate of divorce to our wife? Should she commit adultery or do something that they find unpleasing? And then you hear Jesus' response. He says to them, it was because you were so hard-hearted that Moses allowed you to divorce your wives. Do you see the difference there? They're asking, why is it that we are commanded? Why are we told that we have to divorce our wives? And Jesus says, it's because you are hard-hearted that you are allowed to divorce your wives. There's a big difference there, right? An assumption. For the Pharisees, they believe it's a mandate. If your spouse does something that you're upset with, you are commanded to divorce her. And Jesus, he's offering room for grace. For no matter what has taken place, Jesus is saying it's not required. It's not that it has to happen in every situation, but there is space there for grace, for forgiveness, for reconciliation. For if one spouse harms another, if both spouses harm each other, there's opportunities for them to transform, for them to demonstrate, not only are they sorry, but to then demonstrate repentance, to show that they have changed, to begin to demonstrate the fruit that we talked about last week, to show that, yes, they are now a changed person and they will not be bringing that pain into the relationship anymore. Jesus is saying he's allowing for grace and reconciliation to happen, but he also acknowledges that there are times in which we are hard-hearted. There are times in which maybe we will not change. We will not stop causing one another harm and pain. And it is in those situations that Moses allowed for a divorce. And then finally, Jesus answers the questions that they originally asked. And Jesus says to them, he says, I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for unchastity and marries another commits adultery. Now, I will acknowledge that's an extremely difficult verse. And I will also say there are many scholars and others who interpret it in a variety of ways. Some read it as though Jesus is changing the Old Testament laws and expectations and saying this is the only reason anyone can faithfully get divorced is for adultery, for unchastity. But there are others, and I tend to agree with, when we realize that Jesus is responding to a question, can you divorce your wife for any reason, any cause that you want? Or does it need to be something else? When Jesus highlights adultery, that what he's doing is he's highlighting there needs to be a significant sin present in the marriage. There needs to be significant pain and heartache and hurt. And when I look at Jesus' teachings as a whole, what we usually see is not that he wipes out and throws out the Old Testament. I came to, you know, to fulfill the law, you know, not to get rid of it, Jesus tells us. And so more often what we do is we see Jesus fulfilling what is in the Old Testament but getting to the heart of the matter. And so when I read it and when others read it and study it, you're free to disagree. But when I read this, I don't believe Jesus is saying that adultery is the only reason you can get divorced for. But I believe what Jesus is saying is it needs to be something significant. It's not just for any cause, just because today you decided you no longer want to get married. You need to have a significant reason, significant pain, significant hard-heartedness on the part of one or both spouses for there to be a divorce. I believe that Jesus would withhold. He's not asked about it, so we don't know directly, but I imagine he would withhold those original teachings in the Old Testament about neglect of food, of clothing, of affection, along with adultery. And because we know that Jesus, more often than not, is trying to get to the heart of the scriptures, I believe if we said, now, Jesus, if neglect of food and clothing is a bad thing, is a sinful thing, what about neglect that involves abuse, mental pain, and anguish? Do those things count as well? And now this is Kyle trying to interpret from years of study and what I believe to be true about Jesus. I believe his answer would be yes. That, like we talked about last week, that it can be a loving, faithful thing to establish a barrier that says, I will no longer allow you to harm me and to hurt me. And I don't believe, when we look at Jesus' teachings as a whole, including the scripture, I don't believe it negates that truth. The disciples, though, they acknowledge here. They're used to having freedom. Jesus, we've been told that we can divorce our wives anytime we want. This is a hard teaching that you're giving us. Is it even worth getting married? And then Jesus, he has this whole conversation about eunuchs, but what Jesus is really saying here is, you don't have to get married. Now, again, that's not really surprising to us, but understand that was a bombshell in Jesus' time. I mean, the Jewish people, they took very seriously that command in the Old Testament to be fruitful and multiply. They believed it was a faithful act to get married and to start having children. But when Jesus says, you can choose to remain single, you don't have to have a significant other. No matter how much mom and dad want grandkids, you don't have to get married. You can be a faithful child of God as a single individual. And Jesus is permitting that. So what do we take away from this? Again, this is me talking here, but what I take away as I read this and I look at the scriptures as a whole, is I see that Jesus is saying, look, marriage and the vows and the promises, the commitment you make, they are important. You don't just separate and forget those vows for no reason whatsoever just because you feel like it. They are extremely important. But at the same time, Jesus acknowledges there are times when an individual has sin in their life. We live in a fallen world. Sometimes both individuals may have sin in their lives where they cause pain and heartache and sorrow for one another. And as long as they try to show each other grace and forgiveness, they see if they can change. But if it's just not possible, it's just not going to happen, then I believe that Jesus says that, yes, in those times, you can get divorced and still be a faithful child of God. And to also know and remember that you don't have to get married in the first place. You don't have to have a significant other in the first place. As a single adult, you too can live out your faithfulness and be a servant of God. So how do we do that? What is important as we seek to be a people of faith in the midst of divorce? I appreciate the words of Paul on that topic. In the book of 1 Corinthians, in the 7th chapter, Paul is writing about divorce, and he says, he tells us, he's writing specifically about an individual who's married to an unbeliever. And what he writes here, he tells us that if you're married to an unbeliever who wants to separate and leaves, let it be so. Such is the case, the brother or sister is not bound. It is to peace that God has called you. So in the situation where maybe not both the desire, but one person says this marriage is over, what Paul is saying is let them go, because ultimately it is to peace that God has called you. Now, we might read that and say, yes, Kyle, but Paul is talking about marriage to an unbeliever. So if I'm married to a Christian, we are expected to have anger and animosity towards one another and fight one another tooth and nail and make life miserable for each other. If that's what you believe to be true, fine, but I believe that this applies to Christian marriages as well. If a divorce happens, live at peace with one another. And it breaks my heart when we don't see that. Again, I love my grandmother, and grandfather. For any family who's listening, I love mom and pop, okay? But I can look and say truthfully, I don't think they had the most faithful relationship and the pain that they continued to cause one another and the family in the midst of their divorce. And so how can there be something that's a bit more peaceable? One of the things that hurts as a pastor is I know that we often have divorces in the midst of the church. And even though I try to reach out to both couples and even sometimes try to mediate an opportunity where they can both continue to participate in the life of our church, we know what happens more often than not. Like with many things in a divorce, one spouse gets the church, the Sunday school, the ministry, and we lose and no longer see one of the spouses. Though it's painful, that often is what happens more often than not. And so as I look through and I think about our life of faith and I look at our family of faith, I got to tell you that I found it surprising when after being here for a number of years, I learned that there was a couple in our church that I saw in the same worship service, I saw serving in the same committees, and I saw interacting frequently and realized they had once been married. And so I asked them, I said, would you sit down and share with me just a little bit of wisdom and advice? And they did, and they permitted me to share with you their names and their story. And this is, the individuals are Kathy Bird and Roger Ghost. And I learned in conversation with them, I said, I don't want to have to relive any pain or sorrow or heartache that happened in the divorce, but I just want to know, how did you get to where you are today? Because I'll often see them serving on a committee together. I'll see them out with their family at an event or at a meal together. I got to tell you, not to cast shade at anybody, but when Kathy had her knee replacement earlier, it wasn't Kathy or her kids who let me know that she was having knee surgery. It was Roger who texted me and said, Kathy's having knee replacement today. I know she'd probably appreciate a visit if you can do so. And I thought, that is, and it's sad, but that is so far from what I experience as the norm. And so I said, what happened to get you all here? And what they shared with me is they said, it wasn't easy. There was time. They were married for 17 years, but they've now been divorced for 30. They said it took time. And it took acknowledging that life wasn't going to be the same anymore, but also that life moves on. And they got a choice to choose what that life was going to look like. They participated in mediation. They participated in opportunities to grow with other people and to talk with others who had been through divorce and had done so well and faithfully. They talked about trying to see where each other was coming from, having some empathy, acknowledging the steps that they had walked through. And what they said, the biggest thing, this isn't true for every relationship, but for them, is they had kids together. And they knew that obviously this was going to impact their kids, and they couldn't stop that from happening. But what could they do to minimize that impact, to let their kids know that they continue to love one another, and to also be sure that they continue to love their children, and to make sure that they knew that they wouldn't talk negatively about one another. They wouldn't talk down about their former spouse in front of their children. Roger lifted up how meaningful it was to him that even in the first Christmases after the divorce, when there was still a lot of pain and heartache involved, that Kathy didn't shut him out. That there were some traditions that they still got to participate in and he got to be a part of. And how much he appreciated that and how much it meant to him. And so when I asked him, I said, what wisdom, what advice do you have for couples who may be experiencing heartache, who may have been divorced or may one day experience divorce? And they said, counseling. They said, again, empathy for one another, seeing the steps that they're going through, imagine being in their shoes. They also said, and this is for any couple who goes through a divorce, take care of yourself. You may not want to. You may find yourself experiencing depression, but you have got to eat. You've got to exercise. You've got to spend time with friends and family and be intentional about who those friends and family are. Make sure they are people who are not going to sit there and bash your former spouse over and over again. Find people who in your life who will not be caustic, because they said those caustic words and that caustic talk, it will eat away at you, and before you know it, you will begin to reflect it. And so I appreciated talking to Kathy and Roger and hearing just a little bit of their story of choosing to say, not just once, but over a period of years, choosing that yes, we're divorced. No, we're no longer married. but we still have a deep care and compassion for one another, and most of all for our family, and what can we do to live at peace with one another? And that's my hope and prayer for each and every one of us. And there's so much more that I could say, but I've already probably said too much. But I just want you to know, as you're out there, if you're sitting in here, maybe you've been through divorce, maybe one day you will experience a divorce, I hope you know that you're not alone. I hope you know that, yes, you may have heard tough, hard teachings from pastors and from the church before that tells you if you're divorced, you lack value, you lack purpose, you lack faith. But I'm telling you, you're beloved. And I also want you to know, maybe take a little bit of comfort. You know, in the scriptures, there's places where we can tell that God detests divorce. Do you know why that probably is? It's because when you look at the scriptures, God's often talked of as a divorcee. His relationship with Israel. God knows what it's like to love a people so much, and yet they turn away, and they chase after other things, other gods, material things, and they turn away from the Lord. And often the prophets speak of God's relationship with Israel like a divorce. But is that the end of God's story with humanity? Far from it. God says, I am coming to you, and I am here, and life will continue. And we see it through a new covenant, through a new promise that's developed through the life, the ministry, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I believe what God experienced, God wants for each and every one of us as well. For you to experience as a person of faith, as a member of a community that cherishes and loves you, as a beloved son or daughter of God. God wants you to know that there is new life here and now and abundance for each and every one of us. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we know that we experience heartache in our lives. We experience broken relationships, and that pain never truly goes away. But Lord, we also know that you love and cherish each and every one of us. So it is in celebration of that good news that we give you thanks this day. Remind us in days of ease and in days of sorrow of your presence, of your grace, of your abundant love that never leaves our side. And may we hear and may we claim the truth that no matter what anyone might say about us, we know we are valued, beloved children of God. Amen. It is our hope and prayer here at the Stillwater First United Methodist Church to be a people who experience, receive, and then share the grace and the love of God in all that we do. And even in difficult situations where we find that barriers need to be erected to not allow ourselves to experience harm and pain, may we still find ways to live at peace with the world around us in those situations. And so, as a people of faith, if you're looking for a place where you can experience encouragement, where you can experience the joy and the love of God in your life, know that we'd love to have you join us here at the Stillwater First United Methodist Church. I invite you to see myself, Pastor Kyle, or Pastor Cindy before you leave today. We'll get your name and your phone number. We'll give you a call sometime this week. Set up a time when we get together, get to know one another, and talk about what it means to be a member of the Stillwater First United Methodist Church. And now I invite you to rise in body or spirit, however you're most comfortable, as we sing together our closing hymn, number 707, Hymn of Promise. as a people of faith, in times of joy and in times of sorrow, we are called and invited to see and experience the promise of God within our lives, a promise of God's presence, a promise of God's grace, a promise of God's eternal and unconditional love. May we receive and accept and rejoice in that gift that we are given today, and then may we seek to share it with all the world around us. Go forth in peace. Amen.